Hey, everybody. Thanks for tuning in to another episode of Tinnitus TV. Today, I am talking to Robert Connolly Farr. You know, if you're lucky in this life, sometimes you meet a person who changes your world for the better in a big way. For Farr, that person is Jimmy Duck Holmes. Several years ago, during a trip back to his Mississippi birthplace, the Vancouver singer-songwriter and guitarist met and jammed with the veteran Bentonia bluesman at his Blue Front Cafe, the oldest surviving juke joint in the state. That chance interaction, which quickly blossomed into a musical and personal mentorship, fundamentally changed Farr's artistic trajectory, launching him on the deeper, darker, and more dangerous path he treads on his swampy, southern-fueled album, Shake It, his biggest, baddest, and bluesiest release to date. Shortly after the album arrived, Farr zoomed in from his East Van home, and sort of from the Mississippi Delta, to talk about songwriting, the blues, working with Holmes, and plenty more. Enjoy.
Hey, Daryl, how you doing?
I am good, sir. How are you?
Man, I can't complain. Better now. Good to see you.
Good to see you. Good to see you. You look like you're John Goodman just landed from space in the Mississippi Delta.
That's it. You know, the background picture that's on my Zoom here is not far from where they filmed Oh Brother, Where Art Thou?
Well, there you go. It's all working out.
There you go. Oh, right on. How you doing today?
I am good, sir. Much better now for having the privilege and the pleasure of talking to you.
Thank you for having me. It's an honor.
No. The honor is all mine. I mean, you're a singer, you're a songwriter, you're a guitarist, you're a blues man. Although I might have the order wrong. Which of those should go first in that list, do you think?
Bullshitter.
All right. We'll go with that one. We'll add that to the list. But, you know, you've got a great name for a blues man. I think it has that ring of somebody who should be running a juke joint out in the backwoods in the hill country somewhere. And there are only three options with a name like Robert Connolly Farr. It's bluesman and it's senator, but you'd have to have like a Roman numeral after your name to be a senator, right? You'd have to be the third or the fourth or something.
There you go.
or the other option is presidential assassin. So I think you made the right call.
I think so too. Uh-huh.
Well, let's start with the most recent thing on your resume, which is Shake It, your ninth album in about 12 years. I mean, that is an impressive, I don't know how to describe it, you know, just an impressive resume. Are you just like, do you ever get writer's block, or is it just pick up the guitar and go?
Man, it's been fun, you know, like, the songs they're coming out so quickly now, and I've been really inspired by working with Jimmy and playing some with RL Boyce and seeing how they play and how the songs come out. I remember taking my nephew down to see Jimmy at his juke joint one day. My nephew's about 10, 11 years old at the time, and he walked over to where Jimmy and I were playing, and he said, "Mr. Jimmy, where do you keep your songs?" And Jimmy pointed at his heart. He said, "I keep them right here. I never write anything down." And I was really inspired by that. And I was more so inspired by seeing how it resonated with my nephew, like something took. And I think there's something to that. And watching RL Boyce play, he'll play a song and sometimes you can't even understand the words, but you feel it. You feel it. It just blows me away.
And so how does that influence you as a songwriter when you kind of see that happening and try to take that in?
It's we just released a video on our YouTube called Go Cat Go.
Right.
And it was I was just kind of playing around with the song, and then my drummer and my videographer showed up in the studio, and we just played it, and he shot it, and it came out, and it was so, there was something for me and my drummer that just kind of blew us away about the whole little 10-minute session. And it turned into this single and a video. And, you know, it's, and it just, it was intuitive. It came out. It was a feeling more than a song, if that makes any sense. Mm-hmm. And And it really resonated with us. And I think that process for us, it's a lot. It's how we work the songs in the studio. So like when we go in to record Shake It, you know, we have an idea of what the songs are going to sound like. But like Miss My Baby, Ain't No Other Way, Sugar Mama, all of those songs are totally different from the structures and the progressions that we had going into the studio. It was very much like we're kind of learning and working these songs as we go. So we kind of work them until they feel right. And then that's it.
Well, that's great. I mean, because again, so many bands, you know, they overwork everything and they overthink everything. And it's only natural because, you know, you're writing these songs and you're rehearsing these songs and you're trying to get them perfect or whatever you think of as perfect. But it's really just more about capturing that moment and the feel and going with it.
That's it. And it's largely a process of deduction for us. So, you know, I play with Jay Bundy Johnson, who played for about 20 years with Billy Castle in the Blue Shadows. And he's just a very, very kind of critical aspect of the band. He's always like, can we take that chord out? Can we take that chord out? Can we just hang on one chord? And I like that because that's a lot of what Jimmy does. That's a lot of what the Hill Country Blues is doing, the Bentonia Blues. You know, it's about that one chord and hanging on it and creating that kind of vibe. And it's almost like a train going down the tracks.
Right. Yeah, well, and it's got that almost kind of a hypnotic Eastern mantra, raga. You know, there's a real kind of bridge there between cultures, it seems to me.
It feels that way. It feels that way.
So the other thing I loved about Shake It is it's just a mean motherfucker of an album. I mean, this is it's dark and deep and heavy. And I mean, I know you've gone to this place before in some of your other one, but this one to me is just sort of consistently menacing. You know, it's like being kind of like being stalked by a pack of junkyard dogs. Like the bass is just rumbling and grumbling and growling at you, and the guitars are just snapping and biting. What kind of a mood were you in that this was coming out?
Well, the in life like that, sometimes it just feels like a pack of dogs chasing you on down the road, you know. But no, you know, for me at least, that album, there is a very kind of menacing aspect to it. You know, the bulk of the songs that I wrote, I wrote during a recovery from some cancer and emergency surgeries that I had following that. And what was interesting is because of going through that, I had a different perspective on some things. And it kind of, I was also reading a book on Charlie Patton at the time. And this book, you know, kind of dove into his struggles, and it was a very interesting kind of eye opener for me in that sense that, you know, here's Charlie Patton that comes from the same little town that I come from, and I don't know anything about him, but his struggle over 100 years ago, there's very much a similar struggle now in this small town. You know, I can relate to some of the struggles that he struggled with. And so I think for me, I kind of dove into this record is about a struggle almost, but the reason that we chose Shake It as the title track was from seeing R.L. Boyce play at the Blue Front Cafe one night and just seeing, you know, when you go to the Blue Front, it's hard times, you know, it's a town of about 500 people. And it's a rural community, somewhat impoverished. But when you come together with the music, something beautiful happens, you know, race ceases to be an issue. People come together. There's love in that room. You're having a good time. And even though the world's still hard and, you know, there's a sense of it's going to be all right. And I think that's kind of what the blues was founded on, a sense of hope, a sense of spirituality. And I think in a way, even though Shake It has this kind of dark aspect to it, it also, there's a bit of a hope there, you know, that like, yeah, you know, it's going to come back around, you know, it's going to be all right.
No, that's a lovely thought. I hope you're right.
I do too.
So this seems like a good time to go back to Mississippi, where you were born. And I don't know when you did you grow up there?
I did.
Yeah. Okay. So what was that like growing up there, and how did you kind of discover the blues and you know, embrace that?
Well, you know, it's funny. I didn't know much about the blues growing up down there, and I was not a lot of people know, but I was actually born in Auburn, Alabama in 78. And soon after that, I think within a year or two, we moved back home to Bolton, Mississippi. My dad was in school over there, and we moved back to Bolton, Mississippi, where my family's been from since the turn of the 1900s, I think, a little bit before that. And we moved back there, and I fell in love with skateboarding and rock and roll. And, you know, I didn't know anything about the blues, like anything. And it wasn't
right there in front of your face.
It was right there. I mean, I literally grew up playing in the front yard of Sam Chapman's home, and I'd see the plaque and I'd read about it, but I didn't know what that was. And I just couldn't wait to get out of that town. And fast forward 20 years, you know, I met Jimmy Duck Holmes with my dad one day, and my dad kind of joked. He said, you know, you had to go all the way to Canada to come home and find the blues, you know?
Yeah.
And, you know, that's kind of what it was like. And now I just, you know, I miss home, you know, I just miss home so much. And it's kind of ironic. I couldn't wait to get out of there. And now all I want to do is go back.
How often do you get to go back?
Well, it's not so much lately, but I was home about a year ago, and I'm about to go again. You know, I like to get home 3 or 4 times a year if I can. But it just, you know, it's been kind of tricky the last year or two.
Right. So you've written about that I think, I guess it was the first meeting of you and Jimmy, where your dad was ill, and you took him down there back to, you know, sort of where you were from. Yeah. And was that sort of for you the kind of that moment in like 2001 when the monkeys touched the black rock? It was like the universe just opened up for you.
It really was. I mean, Daryl, I can't, it was, I basically got a call from my parents, and my dad's leukemia had come back, and there was an inoperable tumor anyway, I jumped on a plane. I got home, and they're like, you know, we're not thinking it's as bad as we thought it was before you got on the plane. And I was like, well, that's good. And, so we took a ride up into the Delta and came back down through, Bentonia. And, when we walked into the Juke Joint, so Jimmy's Blue Front Cafe, I remember Jimmy was standing behind the counter, and he introduced himself, and I didn't know who he was at the time. I had just been going by to take pictures of the place. It's a beautiful little building beside a cotton gin. And we sat down, and I asked Jimmy if he'd play a song, and he played Devil Got My Woman. And it was just the three of us in that place. And I shit you not, man, it was a spiritual experience, you know, like I felt it in my bones. And I remember when we left, my dad even mentioned it too, like he felt it. And the fact that he was there with me was very, it meant something. And I came back to Jimmy's place the following day with a friend of mine who's a writer who was going to interview him for a magazine in one of the airline magazines. And that's when Jimmy figured out I played guitar, and we started messing around. And then I went home 3 or 4 times that year. And every time I went out to see Jimmy, and then he flew up to Canada, and we got to be good friends. But what he did was, you know, by him teaching me, he brought music back home for me. Like I've been missing home. I was away from home. And then he gave me this gift that was the music of my home. And he said, you know, try to learn this. And it just, it changed everything for me. Like it changed everything. I just can't put enough emphasis on that. Like that man gave me a gift. He gave it to me. He didn't want anything in return other than to, he said, go tell other people about it. And it blew me away. I'm indebted to him.
So when you say, you know, you went out and started to learn, I mean, what did that involve? Were you just you know, spending hours a day going down rabbit hole with blues artists, or you know, what was involved in that?
Well, he was kind enough to let me ask him if I could videotape his fingers, like how he was playing, what he was playing. And so I would set my camera there and just, you know, videotape 20, 30 minutes of him playing. And I'd go back home for a few months and just try to pick it apart. And it's really, I still don't know how he's doing what he's doing. And I sat down with Paul Pagat. I don't know if you know Paul Pagat, he's a rockabilly player. He's one of the best rockabilly players in the world. He was teaching me at the time, and I sat down with him and I showed him some of these videos of Jimmy playing. He goes, "It sounds like there's three guys playing that guitar." And but you know, Jimmy was, he's like, "You're not gonna get this overnight. You just gotta keep trying. You know, you just gotta keep trying." And I think over the course of time, it just, you kind of work what he's doing into what you're doing, and then you kind of, it ends up being a interesting, different little sound. Like, it's not Jimmy, but it's not supposed to be Jimmy, you know? And, mm-hmm. and Jimmy told me that, you know, he's like, "You don't sound like me. You go sound like you. That's what people are going to hear." You know,
were you writing songs before this, or was this sort of, you know, your first kind of foray into, you know, doing the whole thing?
Well, when I moved up to Vancouver in 2008, I met Mac Pontiac. He's passed away. But he was a big, you know, he inspired me. And he, you know, he's like, "You should go write songs, you know, you should go record." And I met up with a fella here in East Vancouver, and we started making music under the moniker Mississippi Live. And then I got a band, and we called it Mississippi Live and the Dirty Dirty. And we released a few albums that way. And then in 2018, I went out to Alberta and met up with Leroy Stagger, and we made an album called Dirty South Blues. And that was about 6 months after I met Jimmy. And, you know, I'd met Jimmy and I knew that there was something going on with this cancer thing. And songs just started pouring out. And that's where Dirty South Blues came from. And that's when I started using my name. And it kind of started us on this kind of Bentonia blues wormhole kind of thing, you know. And then we did Country Supper and this one.
Yeah, because I mean, your earlier stuff was, you know, there was a lot of blues in there too, right from the beginning. There was some blues, some folk, some blues. Yeah. I mean, it was a little less maybe focused, I think, than
I think so. Know. Yeah.
So I mean, aside from the technical specifics of the blues, you know, the repetition and the 1-4-5 and all that. I've talked about this with other people, and it's an interesting thing, because how do you pin down exactly what the blues is, you know?
That, you know, I don't know if you do. I think that's one of that to me, at least, that's one of the really beautiful aspects of the blues music is, you know, there are standards, right? But you sit down with Jimmy and he'll tell you, he's like, I don't do turnarounds. I don't do bars. You know, I don't, he won't even tune his guitar with a tuner. You know what I mean? Like, that's the beauty of it, you know? And when you hear somebody like Burnside or Kimbrough or R.L. Boyce, and they're playing and it's a little off tune, but they got the whole room moving, you know, like that's magic, you know, that's magic. And so I feel like, in a way, by letting go of the preconceptions of what the blues is, I feel like we're able to kind of at least more honestly dive into that feeling of what this music is. And so you know, I couldn't tell you. I don't know what 12 bar blues is. I don't know what 8 bar blues is. I can play a Bentonia blues, you know, but mm-hmm. That's just the way I learned, you know. And I think there's something to be said about going down to Mississippi and sitting in a juke joint with one of those old fellas and, you know, really just kind of learning from the well, you know, getting that water from the well, so to speak, you mm-hmm. know.
But even down there now, is the water still as pure? Because I would imagine that, you know, at this stage, a lot of those places have become trendy or you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Can you go down there and get the same experience as you did even how many ever years ago with Jimmy?
I think you can. I think you might have to look for it, but I think it's just undeniable. You know, it's, you go into, at least in the Blue Front, you know, you know, they have people stopping by all the time, but I would argue that, you know, 9 times out of 10, what you hear at the Blue Front, what you see, it's going to be very reminiscent of what was happening there 20, 40 years ago.
Mm-hmm. And do you see, I know you're not there all the time, obviously, but do you get the sense that there are a lot of guys like you who are kind of picking this up and carrying that torch? Because a lot of those guys, you know, I mean, a lot of them are gone and a lot of them are on the way out. So, you know, you talk to some blues men and they think that it's kind of a dying craft, you know, that's going to go away with them. Do you get that sense?
Sometimes, you know, but then you see people like Cedric Burnside that yeah. are, you know, keeping that flame alive, you know, and I think that it's important to search out the people that have been doing this for a while and go find them, like R.L. Boyd, you know, Leo Bud Welch, you know. I don't know if you ever got into him, but whoa, sure. I mean, what a huge influence of mine. And I never even saw him live. You know, I did see him live one time and he was sitting under a tent with an oxygen machine waiting to play. And it was hot and I didn't even get to see him play. But watching him like waiting to play in that heat, like just, and then he passed away that year, but his story is amazing. It's so inspirational to know that he was a preacher and the music that you hear on his CDs is how he played it in the church. Yeah. You know, like that's wild. That's wild that you can still go to a church in the South and hear music like that.
I know. I mean, I love all those Fat Possum, basically the whole Fat Possum catalog, especially for the first 5 or 10 years. Was just, you know, CD after CD of who the hell is this guy? But he's been, you know, he's been making music somewhere, you know, for 40 years or whatever. And here's his first album, you know. I mean, I remember once I was at South by Southwest and I've forgotten the guy's name and I'm so sorry. But there was one morning before they had somebody coming on to talk about something or other, said, oh, we're going to have a blues guy come up, and they wheel this guy out. And he is old as the hills, man. And he has one gnarled hand on the fretboard, and he's using a butter knife to play slide.
C. Dell Davis.
Thank you very much.
I love him. I love him.
Yeah. And it was just, it's 9 o'clock in the morning. You've got about 500, you know, hungover people just sitting there, and everyone just stopped talking and jaws dropped, and it was just like, what is going on right now, you know?
Man, I'm blown away. He saw that. I wish I could have seen that. He's been a huge influence of mine lately. I've kind of fallen into a C. Dell Davis wormhole. But what you allude to is that you know, that determination that here's a man that for all intents and purposes maybe shouldn't have been playing the guitar. But he still did it, and he still did it in such a way that it inspired tons of people, still to this day. That, to me, that's incredible. That's incredible. I mean, I remember the last time I saw Vic Chestnut. I didn't even know he was in a wheelchair, and it was a month before he died. Wow. And I saw him get out there on that stage, and he played a show, and he had everybody in the room crying. I mean, it was just amazing. But when music comes from a place of pain and it's used as a source of inspiration and spirituality for the artist. I think that it's just undeniable. It's just undeniable. And it blows me away. And I think for me, those are the artists that I tend to look for, you know, because I, you know, life's hard. Life's hard. And music has always been a source of healing for me. Mm.
Are you a blues purist now, or do you still listen to a lot of stuff?
Everything. In fact, I love rap music that comes out of the South. That's a kind of one of my guilty pleasures. And I love the cadence. I love how people say things that they say. I love good old country music, you know, like I was even listening to Lizzo the other night. I've never even dove into a good Lizzo wormhole, and my wife went to the show, and I'm listening to her songs, and I'm just like, whoa, can she not write a good song? I don't know. So music is a beautiful thing.
And how important is the kind of gear you play it on? How important is that to the process for you, do you think?
It's very important. I use a Epiphone 339, I think, or 335. I'm not sure. I don't have enough money for a Gibson. I use a Union Tone Druid pedal that's made here in East Vancouver. And I use a late 60s little Harmony amp, and that's my sound. I don't mess with it, and I love it. I love it. And so I think simplicity is key in a lot of ways for me. I'm not a gearhead. I don't know that much about, you know, guitars and whatnot. So I try to keep it pretty simple.
Well, that makes sense, though, because that ties in with the music and what you were talking about with, you know, can we take this chord out? Can we take that
That's
chord
it.
Out? Can we strip the beat down? I mean, so much, I think, of especially the kind of blues you play is about making the simplest box, you know, and then just working it.
Yeah. That's what it feels like sometimes. So it feels simple, and to me it's been really cool, because when it feels simple, there's a lot of space, and I feel like we talk about that a lot as a band. Like when the songs have some really good space in it, that's when subtle things start to kind of show up. And I think in the blues, those subtleties are kind of the things that are very intriguing to me. When you listen to some of those old Alan Lomax recordings, you know, like there's subtleties in there, like a foot tapping, you know, mm-hmm. or a shirt sleeve with a button banging on a guitar, you know, and there's a cadence there, you know, there's sounds that show up that I don't know where they come from, but they just show up, and I love those sounds. You know?
Well, yeah, I mean, they belong there. I mean, once I remember I was in a band and we were recording and my bass drum pedal was squeaking, and the engineer spent like hours trying to get rid of this squeak, and I was like, it's just there, man, just leave it.
Yeah,
you know? And we were playing like roots music anyway, so I was like, what's the problem, you know?
That's it.
We're not Journey.
That's it.
so what's your goal as an artist? What would you, you know, what do you want to get to? Where do you want to get to?
It's been interesting the last 2 years. I don't know what my goal is. My wife asks me that question all the time.
sorry to bring up that memory.
Well, it's a good question. It's a good question, you know, and it's something that I've given a lot of thought to. And, you know, I think for me, I'm a songwriter, and I don't particularly want to tour. I want to write songs, and I want to be inspired by my home. And I hope that I'm a good Mississippian. I'm a good representative of my state, because, you know, it's hard down there, and I think America's struggling right now. And so for me, I want to be inspired by my home. I want to write songs that are honest and edify my home and the people that I learn from. And I think that's about it for me. You know, like, I just want to write music and release it. And, you know, that's where the passion is for me.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I know that you've had a couple of, songs licensed. They've shown up on TV, right?
Yeah. Yeah. That's something that we've been really trying to kick that can on down the road.
Oh,
yeah.
I mean, what's that experience like? Cause I mean, you know, it's still probably something where you go, oh, hey, wait a second, you know,
it's definitely, it's an angle that I've been working for about a decade now. And I've gotten tied in with a couple of good music supervisors. And I think kind of diving into that obscure Mississippi sound is, you know, there's a market for that. And I kind of like that, you know, it's simple. And, you know, the idea of, you know, going out on the road and, you know, I read an article earlier today where it's talking about artists that are touring right now are suffering a lot because there's just not a lot of people coming out to the shows, you know? So with that in mind, it's like, what can you do as an artist? You know, like, I think we got to kind of step back and reimagine some things and take a sober look at what it is we're doing, because the industry is just changing so much. And, you know, as an artist, I think you want to feel like your work is succeeding. You know, you don't want it to be a struggle all the time. So it's tricky.
Yeah. But for you, I mean, you could go out with just your drummer really, and you could, you know, do all the folk festivals across Canada, you know?
Yeah, you know, it's, and Leo Bud Welch, I mean, he used to travel around with one drummer, like, forever, and I'd love to do that.
Do it, man. Let's make this happen. Let's get you out to all, you know, let's get you, because they all go, you know, there's that nice little chain goes all the way across the country. You could go all the way out to the east and back over the course of a summer.
Well, you know, it's something I'd love to do. I would love to do it. And who knows? It might happen.
Well, we would love to have you. And you know, since these songs now just come, you know, you plug in, you sit down, you start playing. I'm guessing we're going to have like another album, what, tomorrow, next week?
Well, it's already written, I could tell you that much.
Now it just has to be rewritten, right?
Well, we just got to record it. But yeah, you know, like, that's the fun part. You know, we've been talking with Jimmy. We want to get him up here in the early part of 2023, and hopefully sit down with him in the studio and get another album cut for him and do something together. That's something that we haven't done yet. And so we're hoping to do that. We have another album that's written that we need to record. So, but I think right now we're just going to push this one and see what we can do with it. But I think you're right. You know, we'd love to get out to Toronto and the East Coast and do some little duo shows and, you know, see how that goes.
Oh yeah, for sure. And getting Jimmy up here would be great. I mean, that his last album was fantastic. I really like what Auerbach's doing, because in a way it's kind of the same thing as the Fat Possum stuff, but read a little larger, you know, where he brings them into Easy Eye and he has his band and they kind of, you know, give everything that big boost. It's a fantastic thing he's doing.
I've been inspired by him and I appreciate his dedication to the elders and looking back to the people that have influenced the younger generation of today, either on purpose or inadvertently. And I think there's a lot of obscure artists that have inadvertently influenced, you know, tons of artists. And I think those people need to be lifted up. You know, and I like what he's doing. And I don't know if you've read about the backing band that he records with in his studio. Legends, you know, and that's another aspect that I think is really beautiful about what he does, you know.
Oh yeah, well, it's like it's almost like a recreation of that whole old Muscle Shoals,
exactly, yes,
you know, same studios thing. you know, where there's just these guys who just shuffle in and sit down and knock it out of the park and go and drink, you know, or vice versa, you know.
Love it. Love it.
So talking about passing the torch and all that, do you know, when you do go out and play in Vancouver, do you get the sense people get it? Are there, you know, younger people who come and see you and kind of are into this?
Yeah, it's been fun. Like, there's definitely, when people hear it, it resonates, you know, and we played the Burnaby Roots and Blues Festival this year, and that was a lot of fun. It was really cool to see a crowd of people gather at the front of the stage and start dancing, you know, like that was just, it was just electric, and it just, it blew me away. I think seeing that happen at the Blue Front Cafe and then seeing it happen up here, it just, there's something undeniable about that music. Like when I listen to the Shake It album now, like I want to move, you know. And that was something that was so intriguing to me about that album, was it was the first album that we cut as a band where I wanted to move, you know, like every single song, even though the beats per minute changes a lot on that album. Yeah. Every single song has this kind of groove that is reminiscent of that Bentonia sound. I like how my drummer puts it. He's like, it's not a circle, it's an oval. And there's a kind of momentum there. And I like that. I like that. And I appreciate the fact that the guys in the band are constantly critical of what we're doing. You know, like if it sounds too straightforward, drummer doesn't want to have nothing to do with it, you know. But when it sounds weird, he's into it.
Well, I can't think of a better motto. So is the next one going to be even weirder? Is that what you're saying?
I hope so. And I think we might do it as a duo, like a true, just a drum and guitar record. Our bass player had a bad car wreck earlier this year, and he's been recovering. And so it's been interesting because it's forced us into like, okay, well, we want to keep this momentum going. How can we do that? And so the drummer, Jay, and I, we've been very intrigued by some of these older duo blues bands. And so we're like, maybe we should try that, see if there's another little avenue, little wormhole we can kind of crawl into. So
go for it. These days you can, because I mean, you know, nowadays there are duos everywhere. It's not like people are going to get up and go, where's the bass player? You know, they're used to it.
Yeah. And some of the, you know, like this hill country and this Bentonia blues, there's so much, it's very kind of Travis picky in a way. Like you're always picking with your thumb, you're always picking with your fingers. And so there's a tempo that the guitarist is setting in a way, and there's bass lines that the guitarist is kind of, you know, you listen to, a Junior Kimbrough or R.L. Burnside, you know, and it's just, it blows me away. That's who I've been into a lot lately is Junior Kimbrough. Blowing me away, you know, like the cadence and the rhythms and how it's sometimes he doesn't even know where he's going. And then he gets there and then he's there, you know, and it's like, whoa, like that's, you know, it doesn't have to be put together going into it. You can just have fun, you know, and that blows me away. I'm really inspired by that.
Well, that's great. And it is inspiring. And I think it's also true though, that you've put in your hours and your time and learned the lessons, because that's the other thing. It's like learning all the rules in order to ignore them, you know what I mean, and figure out, because you know, you see a lot of people who get up and they try and do that and they can't pull it off because they don't have the foundation or the experience or all the, you know, the 10,000 hours or whatever that guys like you and Junior and all these other people have put in to know that, okay, I can get up and I can start the ball rolling and I'm not going to get run over by it, you know.
That's a good way to put it. That's a good way to put it. But you know, it's I think it's important to kind of, you know, when you talk about that 10,000 hours, you know, like I remember when I started cutting records in 2009, and I just wanted to be somewhere I wasn't, and the band was, you know, very like, hey, let's just, you know, let's just explore, And then 15 years later, you're in this place where you feel so good about it. And, but you're right, there's a lot of work to get there. And I don't think I'd change that at all. You know, I wouldn't change any of that. Like, I don't think I even knew what I wanted when I started, you know, I think now all I want is just to keep exploring, you know, and that's the beauty of it.
Well, I personally can't wait to see what you come up with next and where you go with the exploring next.
Well, thank you so much, man. It's been really nice to talk with you.
Yeah, same here. Thanks for your time today, and thanks for all the music. And for God's sake, get that drummer, get in the van, get on the Trans Canada, play some festivals, bring it to the rest of the country.
Well, I hope to cross paths with you one day.
All right, sir. First beer's on me when we do.
Thank you, sir. All right, take care of yourself. One. All right.
Bye.
Bye-bye.